Today, I am going to teach you about diet breaks and refeeds. This is a very, very popular topic. It is a strategy that we use at Tailored Coaching Method with damn near all of our clients. I don't run into many people who won't benefit from a diet break, even though the benefit of the diet break is a little bit different than we thought it once was. See, originally we thought there was these huge hormonal shifts when we did a refeed or a diet break. There used to be this like stigma or this myth that if you took a cheat meal or a cheat day, you would speed up your metabolism. And they believed that this higher intake of calories on a single day or multiple days increased leptin and ghrelin, which are hunger hormones that signal your metabolism to speed up. However, what we realized is that's not really the case. Any type of leptin increase or ghrelin change in the body isn't going to happen unless we take full maintenance breaks or time away from the diet or put back on body fat. So a diet break is much more psychological than it is hormonal or physiological. However, we do know that indirectly, there are probably some physiological responses that occur or benefits that occur over time. We can't directly point to these in a study, but what we do know from working with hundreds and hundreds of people is that if we implement diet breaks, we manage stress a little bit better, they're able to train a little bit harder and recover from that training a little bit better, most likely they're going to see shifts in their physiology, whether that is from cortisol reductions or it is directly impacting their ability to burn more calories because they have more motivation, which is psychological. So there's definitely a bridge that's tied here, and the biggest benefit is psychological. It's simply time away from the diet. But I wanna teach you how to use them because I think everybody should really be using diet breaks in some way, shape, or form. First, we're gonna go over this graph so you know why you would even want a diet break or when you should think about considering implementing a diet break or refeed. And real quick, the difference between a diet break and a refeed really is nothing. A refeed is typically 1 to 2 days, and the main focus is replenishing glycogen. We are refeeding and we are refueling our muscles by eating more carbs, storing the carbs in the muscle cells so we have more energy for training. That's really all a refeed is. So when we extend a refeed to 2, 3, 4, 5 days, 6 days, 7 days, 14, 21 days, it becomes a diet break and then eventually a maintenance phase where we're just eating maintenance calories, trying to avoid any further weight loss. But back to this graph, what we see here is the dashed line being diet fatigue and the straight line being weight loss or the duration of the diet and or can kind of be interchangeable. But what we see here is as the diet goes on longer and the weight loss goes down further, so you're losing more and more weight, diet fatigue slowly increases. Right, so we get to a point where diet fatigue starts to overpass the amount of weight we're losing. And even if we are losing weight, we are starting to feel it more and more. Diet fatigue is a term that I use to really explain any type of biofeedback decline. So whether we are seeing cortisol starting to increase, so stress is going up, testosterone or thyroid function starting to decrease, so our hormonal profile isn't as helpful or isn't as healthy, I should say. And psychologically, it's getting harder and harder and harder to follow the diet. Maybe we're even getting fatigued, feeling lethargic, not wanting to move as much, we're sleeping poorly. All of these things are in an umbrella of biofeedback. These are the signals our body is giving us to say, hey, stop dieting for a little bit. Take a break because I can't sustain this for very much longer. So what we try to do is be proactive instead of reactive. Before we get to this point where diet fatigue is accumulating so high, and we know we're not gonna be able to sustain this diet, we're gonna take a diet break before that happens. So when we start feeling the diet fatigue just a little bit, that's a signal to us that soon the diet fatigue is gonna accumulate and be much greater. And if we allow it to get much greater, the problem with that is it could potentially lead to us completely falling off the diet, binging, or worse. So what we wanna make sure we do is when we start seeing this increase and we feel that diet fatigue accumulating just a little bit, we're gonna be proactive and implement a diet break to avoid the binge, avoid the rebound, avoid the regain, and avoid falling off the diet completely, losing that motivation. The biggest thing that we need to do during a diet break is just simply bring up calories via carbohydrates. That's a classic refeed or a diet break, and I'm gonna show you exactly what those structures might look like. But the big thing is that we're just trying to bring our calories up to maintenance. That's priority number one. Priority number two is gonna be bringing them up via carbohydrates because typically carbs are gonna be better utilized if we go into maintenance or a surplus. We know that our body uses that as its preferred fuel source for training. So if we increase carbs, we're most likely going to burn them and use them as muscle glycogen, where if we increase fat, yeah, we might feel better because our calories go up, but we're probably gonna store some of that as body fat, and that's not what we want. But There are times where we recommend an intuitive diet break. And this is where maybe the diet break is needed more so psychologically. Maybe you're going on a trip and you don't want to track at all, or the stress of tracking and calculating your macros and weighing your food, that's what's getting you down, not necessarily your sleep or your fatigue in the gym. And in that case, we might say, hey, don't track your calories for a week or two. We just want to take an intuitive diet break, let you refresh in your mind, and then we're going to jump back into it when you have full motivation. Just practice moderation. That's acceptable too, and it's kind of like level one, level two. Level one's going to be more advanced. If you want to be more specific about your physique goals, I would recommend doing so, bringing up carbohydrates. If you want to be not so advanced, you're not so worried about the physique per se or building muscle or anything like that, and you just want to get through the diet, an intuitive diet break is totally fine. Regardless, you want to be proactive, not necessarily reactive. The last thing I'm going to go over is basically, how do we program this in? How do we structure this? And it's really, really simple. You can do a 6-day deficit with a 1-day refeed or maintenance period. You can do a 5-day deficit with a 2-day refeed or maintenance period. You can do a 7-day deficit with a 2-to-4-day refeed, 10-day deficit with a 3-to-5, 14, 3-to-7, 12-day, 7-to-14, 4-to-8 weeks with 7-to-14 days, 1-to-2 weeks in place. And so as you can see, it's really just a scale of how often do you need it, right? So a classic 6-1 approach is basically like you start a diet and you want to lose weight, but you really love training, so you want to make sure you have fuel for training. So you have 1 day a week where you have high carbs just to refuel for some of your glycogen before your like second leg day, which is Saturday, and that's the most difficult training session that you have all week. Not only is it legs, but it's the second leg day of your week. So you take a refeed day to make sure you can get through that training session while you're dieting and diet fatigue is accumulating. Or maybe you start a diet and you're looking to lose fat, but you love going out and having some drinks with your friends, with your husband, with your wife, whatever it may be, every single Saturday. This is my situation. So every Saturday is my refeed, purposely just because I want to have a little more flexibility to make sure I can have a few glasses of wine and whatever the hell I want to eat for dinner. It's an intuitive day for me to eat a little bit more calories. In 6 days, I would be in a deficit. You can make this more of a weekday weekend approach, which has been studied by Dr. Bill Campbell's lab recently, where we do a 5-day deficit and a 2-day refeed. This is another good option. However, we do need to go into a bigger deficit because it's even less days of the week that we're in that deficit. So this is typically going to be a 15-25% deficit, which is a pretty aggressive approach because we have 2 days every week that we're taking at maintenance. So our weekly caloric intake goes up. So no matter what strategy you use, that's one thing that you have to be aware of. Yes, you might be in a deficit here, but how big is your refeed? Is it taking you out of that weekly deficit that you need to be in? Average out the week, see where your weekly calories are on average, and make sure that that is always in a deficit no matter what. You can go 7 days on with 2-to-4 days off. You can go 10 days on, 3-to-5 days off, and again, the scale kind of goes on. Anything past 21 days, in my opinion, 3 weeks, that's where we start having more maintenance phases occur. So maybe you go 8 weeks on a diet and you take 4 weeks off. It is a diet break because you're going to get back to it, but it's more of a maintenance phase because we're passing a full month. Or you might go 16 weeks straight of dieting, every once in a while having a single day refeed just for social events that you have coming up. And then after that 12 to 16 week period of dieting, you take a full 6 to 12 weeks off the diet completely, and then you attack it again. That's where we're phasing in between fat loss and maintenance phases throughout the months and years. The last thing I will say about this too is we might start right here, and then go here, and then go here, and then go here, and then go here without ever reducing daily calories. So if I have a client who's getting results on a 5-2 approach, they're doing really well, we're having a moderate deficit, couple refeed days, and it's easy for them to adhere to, and they're seeing results. Maybe they're losing 0.5 to 1% of body weight per week, which is what we want in a healthy, sustainable weight loss fashion. But after 4 to 5 weeks, they start to plateau. Maybe now they're not losing as much weight per week. In fact, they don't lose any weight. Why? Because they're probably not in a weekly caloric deficit anymore. We need a deficit in order to lose weight. So what I might do is take them from 5 days to 2 days, but keep that 2-day refeed in place. So now we have 2 extra days in a deficit. If that doesn't work, I might go to 10 days. Or if I feel like they have a more stubborn body, because we all know those individuals, as coaches, we know the clients, as clients, you know yourself, where your body just doesn't want to cooperate. It's a little bit more stubborn when it comes to losing weight. I might jump right from 5 days all the way to 14, 10 or 14 days. And I just want more time in the deficit because there's certain people where it's not so much about how big the deficit is, although that typically works well for anybody. It's about how long they're in the deficit. Their body has this resistance to finally get with the program, or it takes them a little bit to actually adhere to the deficit you're giving them. So giving them only 5 days doesn't give them long enough to reap the rewards of the deficit itself. So I might jump to a little bit further. My favorite way of doing this is the last thing I will say. My favorite way of programming this for clients is almost always going to be 2 weeks on or 3 weeks on with 1 full week off. This tends to be the best ratio for both achieving fat loss because you have 2 to 3 full weeks where you're in the deficit. That is enough time to guarantee we are in a deficit, you are guaranteed to lose weight because that is 2 to 3 full weeks of trying to lose weight. We know that. Then we have a full week off the diet, which although we don't have studies to prove that there's hormonal benefits the longer the diet break is, because I believe you're gonna have to take a diet break for 3, 4, 5 plus weeks, be in a maintenance phase to start seeing those hormonal changes really start to reverse. However, we know that a 7-day diet break is gonna be the most psychologically refreshing. You're going to truly de-stress your mind from the diet fatigue that's accumulating. We know you're gonna tap out your muscle glycogen stores. You're really gonna fill yourself back up. It gives you enough time away that you're motivated to get back to the diet because you haven't been dieting for a full week. So that 2 to 3 week period that you go back to doesn't seem as hard. And we're most likely going to have the biggest cortisol reduction, stress relief, because we're out of the diet for a significant amount of time. So in my opinion, if we want any type of physical, physiological, and psychological changes, a 7-day diet break or more is probably gonna be our best bet getting close to it. And again, although we don't have studies to prove there's physiological changes, what I have seen with clients is that when we take a solid 7 days, that's when we do notice a slowdown, whether it's from the psychological benefits or not, we see the biggest slowdown of these metabolic adaptations that occur during a diet. Because we know if we diet and we go into deficit, you will see metabolic adaptation. It's just a part of the process. However, if we take these diet breaks, we may be able to slow that down simply because it's less time in the deficit. You're still going to see metabolic adaptation. This is not a cure for metabolic adaptation. If you are in a deficit over a 16-week period, I don't care how many refeeds you take. In the grand scheme of things, you're still in a deficit. However, by the end of that period of time, if we average out your calories, you're in a slightly less of a deficit than you would have been if you just went straight through it. And that may give us some benefit. But at the end of the day, even if there is no physiological, no physical benefits to this whatsoever, and it's all psychological, it's worth it because it will help you stick to the diet for longer and adhere better when you're in the diet, so you're more consistent, more precise, and you're gonna get better results throughout the whole process.